pleased in your presence. Play that. There is nothing you cannot do. I stand amazed in your presence. There is joy, peace, and hope. I stand amazed. I stand amazed in your presence. There is nothing you cannot do. I stand amazed in your presence. There is joy, peace, and hope. Come on, there's no one like you. There's no one like you. Jesus, Jesus. There's no one, there's no one like you. In all the earth, in all the earth, there's no one like you, Jesus. There's no one like you. You do mind. You do glorious, glorious things. You're a faithful, God. Awesome beings. Awesome is your name. You do mighty things. You do mine. You do glorious. You're a faithful, faithful God. Awesome is your name. You do mighty. You do mine. You do glorious. You're a faithful God. Awesome is your name. You do mighty things. You do glorious things. You're a faithful God. Awesome is your name.
Go ahead and give him praise this morning. Just bless his name. Bless his name. Bless his name. Mighty God. Mighty God, Father, we worship you. Father, we exalt you. We worship your holy name, O God. You're a glorious God. You do mighty things. Father, we thank you. We glorify you. In Jesus' name we pray. And let the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Look at somebody and say, God is good. This morning, I want to continue the message I started a couple of weeks ago, titled, The Heart of a Champion. So today, I'll treat part two, and then I'll have one more of that message to preach, and then we'll wrap it up. The Heart of a Champion. Look at somebody and say, the Heart of a Champion. Ask him, do you have the heart of a champion? Ask him another question. What is the heart of a champion? Remember, I told you, I said, life is full of struggles. You know, when I started, life is full of struggles. Life is full of challenges. Life is full of battles. Life is full of circumstances that sometimes are beyond your control. So overwhelming, so intimidating, that they want to crush you. That is life 101. It comes to everybody, to the politicians, to the non-politicians, the guys in Wall Street. Whether you're married or not married, whether you're a child, an adult, life is, it just can be very tempestuous. But you need to be a champion. And who is a champion? I told you, remember, by definition, dictionary definition, a champion is one who has defeated or subdued his opponents in every competition. Somebody who fights or defends another person or a thing. When you fight for your health, and you overcome, you're a champion. When you fight for your children and you overcome, you're a champion. When you fight for what is yours and you overcome, you're a champion. A champion is a fighter, a warrior, a man who does not back down and take no for an answer. That is a champion. A man who does not succumb. You don't cower to the tauntings, the intimidations, the contempt, the disdain of the devil. That is a champion. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 9, the Bible says, it says, there yet remains a rest for the people of God. There yet remains a rest for the people of God. So rest is tranquility, it's calm, it's peace, stability. You remember in 1 Peter chapter 5, where God says that he will strengthen you, he will establish you, he will perfect the things that concern you, and he will settle you. That is rest. When you have gone through the storms of life and gotten to a place of settlement, when you have gone through the fog of uncertainties and travails and the burdens of life and come to a place where you have been established, that is a champion. And it's possible, because in that same Hebrews chapter 10, it says, therefore, let us, chapter 4, sorry, verse 10, it says, let us struggle, let us press on. He said, for those who have entered his rest have ceased from his works. You've got to fight your way through. After you have succeeded, you cease, you relax. You know, presidential election is going on now. The candidates started way since last year. It's been a struggle. You know, you go through the primaries, sleepless nights. You talk until your voice becomes coarse or hoarse. You pretend to smile when you don't feel like smiling. You love babies when you don't feel like loving them. You know, or you hate them when you don't feel like, you know, it's you're going through that struggle so that you may enter your rest. Come November 8, by 9 or 10 p.m., a president will be elected, and suddenly you enter your rest. That is a champion. Look at somebody and say, struggle. Go ahead, struggle. Fight your way through. In verse 11, let's go back. In verse 11, he said, therefore, he said, press on. I want you to press on, verse 11. He said, let us therefore be diligent to enter the rest. Let's push our way through. Let's struggle our way through. Oh, no wonder the Bible says that. It says, fight the good fight of what? Of faith. You've got to fight it. You've got to fight for your life. Fight for your children. If you cannot sleep at night, every time you see a cow with a scarf pursuing you, fight against that cow. Rebuke that cow. Let it return to wherever it came from. You know, cows should not be pursuing you at night, should they? You sleep at night and you see snakes becoming your pillow. You've got to fight. Rebuke the snakes in Jesus' name. I shared some of you a story many years ago when I had chicken pox as an adult. And if you know anything about chicken pox as an adult, it's rapidly fatal. You know, I had chicken pox. And that night, I remember my sister went around. She said she just felt an unusual presence in the house. She went around anointing the house with oil. Later that night, you know, I was so much pain, so much excruciating pain. I remember when I first shared this story, I said it's like having, you know, having going through labor without anesthesia. You know, I don't want to tell you what's going through my heart now. You know, so as I went to bed that night, my head, I slept on the opposite side of the bed. I hadn't gone to work for a while. I hadn't gone to church. I slept, you know how your pillow is normally here, but that night I put my head on this other side, you know, facing the window. And I saw death walk into the room. I was in so much pain. I couldn't pray. I couldn't, you know, but death walked into the room, the skeleton of death. Walked into the room and tried to lie down on me. I just rolled away and I smiled. I said, death, what are you doing? You know, I smiled. And then later on, I felt it come from behind me, trying to choke life out of me. I struggled my way through until I screamed, Jesus. Despite the pain, despite the agony, I knew this was a matter of life and death. I got up that night and started rebuking the spirit. I bound the spirit, I prayed and cast out the spirit. And to confirm that was true, about 2 weeks later, a friend of mine, a couple, they were praying. I went to their house and they were praying with me. And after I had left, the wife told the husband that she saw skeleton lying, you know, attached to my body. You know, so which was the spirit, exactly the image of what I had seen. That she saw a skeleton, half part of skeleton attached to my body. Oh, when they told me that, I said, thank God, my deliverance has come. Listen to me, your deliverance will come in Jesus' name. You, God has made you a champion. He made you to reign. The Bible says that God made us to have what? Dominion over our enemies. I'd like you to listen because this is a prophetic message. Your life will never be the same again if you will listen carefully to this word. In Deuteronomy 28 verse 13, the Bible says that I have made you to be the head and not the tail. I have made you, musicians, from now on, you won't be sitting on that row again. You'll be sitting, you'll be facing me, this side. Okay? Those, you are all champions. You're all champions. You'll be sitting here. Sitting here. Yes. I have made you the head and not the tail. He said, you shall be above only and not beneath. May God do that for you in Jesus' name. Above, above, ahead, not behind, ahead, ahead. God made you to reign. In Proverbs 14:34, the Bible said that righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Sin has a way of crippling your life. Sin has a way of damaging your enthusiasm. Sin has a way of limiting your verve. You want to progress, but sin will pull you back. Sin has always, Proverbs 14:34. It says, righteousness exalts anybody, but sin is a reproach to any people. Growing up as a kid, I used to know some enterprise, some business endeavor that was a thriving business at the time. But later on, stories went around as I grew older and I read some books and I discovered, they said that family made their money through slave trade. The man, the family, they used to sell slaves. They used to sell their own people as slaves. So even though they became very wealthy, but because it was a world that was founded not on righteousness, it was only a matter of time it was going to collapse. So today, the children from that family did not amount to anything. The grandchildren are useless and nobodies. Even though they were so wealthy, they had a heritage of perverse wealth. But today, they live in abysmal poverty. Sin will cripple you. Righteousness will exalt a nation. Righteousness will exalt an individual. My friend, don't be fooled. The Bible says that, it said the way of sin is death. How does it put it? It said, there's a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof is a way of death. It may look appealing. It may look tantalizing. All the devil's apples are full of worms. Regardless of their lusciousness, regardless of the appeal that they offer to you, sin will cripple you. But God wants you to reign. Joseph was a slave, but he was reigning. So regardless of your limitations, regardless of your situation today, you may say, well, I do not have Shola Shegun. I've not been settled. No, in spite of that situation, you can still reign. You can reign in the sphere of your habitation. You can reign in the sphere of your existence. Joseph was a slave. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 39, verse 3, it says, and the Lord blessed Joseph and showed him favor and caused everything he did to prosper. He was a slave, yet he was reigning. Esther was a slave girl, an orphan who had lost her parents. But because of righteousness, because of the grace and the glory of God upon her life, she reigned. What of Daniel? Daniel, one of the young men, ebullient, healthy young man who was captured into a Babylonian captivity. They were subjected to a lifestyle and a culture that was alien to what they had been brought up with. But Daniel, even in captivity, he reigned. I declare to you today, if God has brought you into this land, may you reign in the name of Jesus God. You reign. God has asked you. You may not control your destiny, but you can control your environment. You may not control your circumstances, but you can control how you respond to your circumstances. Joseph could not control his circumstances. His siblings connived.
and they sold him to slavery. But Joseph made up his mind that these circumstances will not crush me. I've been sold to slavery. The woman, Potiphar, fabricated lies about him. And again, they cast him in the dungeon. But even in that circumstance, Joseph rose up and he grew stronger and greater. May God make that a reality in your life in Jesus' name. In Joshua chapter 14, verse 6 to 15, we see the portrait of a champion. A man who overcame the hardships, the difficulties, the death, and the bereavement that he encountered and he overcame. You know, something, when Pope John Paul II died, I was really intrigued about the man. I was fascinated by his life, and I wanted to study a little bit more and more and more about him. So I read almost every material that was put on the newspaper. I read about him. What will make the world stand still for the death of a Catholic Pope? One man. People flocked into Egypt, into Italy, flocked the Vatican because that man died. And I realized that in the life of that man, he was one of the most traveled popes. He went around the world, and every time he got to any nation, the first thing he did as he disembarked from the plane, the first thing he did was he kissed the soil of that ground. He kissed the soil. I realized that this was a man who went through a lot of pain. He had only one sibling, I think one brother, and that brother died when he was young. His parents died, and this man was left alone. He knew loneliness. If you may not understand what death does to somebody. I remember when my mother died, there was this loneliness, this emptiness in your heart that nothing can fill. When you go through an experience like that as a young man, where his family members had all died, he was left alone. No wonder he committed himself to making an impact in the world. No wonder he committed himself to touching the lives of people, changing the lives of people, affecting other destinies. Even though he was handicapped internally, even though he was handicapped in his family background, yet he decided that he would do good and bless others. My brother, my sister, I do not want you to tell me that your handicap has made you what you are. In fact, I'll deal with that. Caleb, in this passage, was a young man who encountered a lot of bereavement. Out of the about 2 million people who came out of Egypt, only himself and his friend Caleb were the two people who entered the promised land. You think it was easy to look at his contemporaries, his colleagues, his friends, his boyfriends, his girlfriends, perhaps his fiancée also died in the wilderness. His parents, his uncles, his cousins, his aunties, they all died in the wilderness. It wasn't easy for him. But this man, the Bible says that when Moses appointed 10 spies or 12 spies to go spy the land, when they came back, 10 of them came with an evil report. But Caleb was one guy who came with a good report next to Joshua. He came from the tribe of Judah, and Joshua came from the tribe of Joseph, but directly from the lineage of Ephraim. Two of them, they were the only two people who survived the mass execution of the people in the wilderness, the ordeal of the wilderness, 40 years in the wilderness until he entered the promised land. May I declare to you today, may you not die in the wilderness of your life in Jesus' name, because your best days are ahead of you. There are better days ahead of you. The glory of God upon your life is going to break out in the years to come in the name of Jesus Christ. So now Caleb was in the promised land, and in Joshua chapter 14, he came to Joshua. Now 45 years had elapsed, and Caleb came to Joshua in verse 6. He says, then the children of Judah came to Joshua in Gilgal, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said to him, you know the word which the Lord said to Moses, the man of God, concerning you and me in Kadesh Barnea. I will quickly run through a narrative in that passage from verse 6 through to verse 15 and give you some of the portraits of a champion. The Bible says the children of what? Stay with me. Look at it. It's on the screen. The children of what? Came to who? And the next sentence says what? And Caleb, the son of Jephunneh. Judah was a tribe. Ephraim was a tribe. When the children of Judah came to Joshua, the Bible begins to tell us about Caleb. What does that tell us? A champion becomes the reference in his family. You become the reference in your family. You become the reference in your office. You become the reference in your workplace. You become the reference in your community of friends. Will somebody say amen?
Amen.
In Genesis chapter 37, verse 1 and verse 2, the Bible says, Genesis 37, verse 1 and verse 2, now Jacob dwelt in the land where his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. The Bible goes on in verse 2. It said, now this is the history of Jacob. Or one translation says, this is the genealogy of Jacob. One translation says, this is the generation of Jacob. The writer wanted to talk about Jacob. But who does he start with? He says, Joseph, being 17 years of old. It goes on and on and on and talks about Joseph. May God make you the reference in your family in the name of Jesus. That is a champion. There are some of you in your families, when they have meetings, you cannot talk, because when family members are talking, they tell you that your voice is not relevant. Not because of your biological age, but because of your personal worth or net worth, as the case might be. That's because on a scale of measuring people who are valuable and significant, your weight is almost insignificant. Your weight is almost minutiae. It really does not count. Your voice is as though you had no voice. So when you open your mouth to speak, you know, the Bible says that a wealthy man has many friends, but that even his own brothers are ashamed and afraid of him. May God reverse that for you in the name of Jesus. So Caleb was a reference in his family. A champion becomes the standard by which other standards are evaluated. If God has brought you this far, if God has kept you this long, you will be the reference in your office in the name of Jesus. You will be the reference in your family in the name of Jesus. In my heart, I believe that God is doing a new thing. You know, well, I'll talk about that sometime in the future. The month of August is the month of beginnings. The number 8 stands for beginnings. And the God we serve is a God of seasons and times. He works with the seasons and he works with the times. I dare you today to reach out your faith and hold on to God and say, in this season of new beginnings, I believe you are doing something new. You will do something new. You must do something new in my life. Do I have a witness here today? You're the reference. Number 2, a champion is matured. Look at verse 7 of that passage, that Joshua chapter 14, verse 7. Verse 7, please. Give me a second, please. I'm looking at something else. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Good. Verse 7. It said, I was 40 years old. I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to spy out the land. And I brought back word to him as it was in my heart. Number one, I said, a champion is what? What is a champion? Become the reference, right? Number 2, a champion is matured. 40 in scriptures is the age of maturity. 40. Moses, 40 years old, he wanted to rescue the children of Israel. God said, no, you've not yet matured. He sent him to the University of the Wilderness, the desert campus, for another 40 years of training until he got to the age of maturity. The children of Israel went through the wilderness for how many years? For 40 years. Jesus Christ fasted for how many days? For 40 days. Moses fasted for how many days? For 40 days. Elijah went for 40 days. 40 is the age of maturity. A champion is matured. A champion is not moved by the winds of times and people and comments and seasons. There are some of you who you cannot endure a little hardship, a little inconvenience. Oh, you hurt my feelings. I'm not going to church again. Oh, the way you spoke to me, I don't like it. Take off my name from your contacts, and you delete their name from their contact. You are immature. You cannot be a champion. The Bible says that a child, in Galatians chapter 4, it says that as long as a her, that is, as long as a potential champion is still a child, he will still be controlled by masters. You are a potential champion, but you're still a child. You'll be controlled by masters. And the Bible says in Ecclesiastes, it says, woe to you who are led by children. You eat in the morning and you eat anyhow. He said, you are led by children, you will never reach your destiny. But may you reach your destiny in the name of Jesus. Grow up. Stop giving excuses. Joseph had 1,000 reasons to fall and fail. 1,000 reasons. To be bitter and angry. And to bless everybody with an anointing of bitterness. Because his family sold him. A woman lied on him. I mean, his own family rejected him. That's the ultimate rejection. Some people have said, well, Joseph was talking too much. Why did he tell his brothers his dream? If you don't tell your own family, who else would you tell? If you don't tell your prayer partner, who else would you tell? Joseph had 1,000 reasons. Samuel had more than enough reasons not to live right. A young boy taken by his family, his parents, and left in the temple under the supervision of Eli. And the only mentors, the only role models he saw were Dukes of Hazzard, Eli's children, who were wayward, godless, and ungodly. Those were the only role models he saw. And yet that young boy lived right. Yet that young boy controlled himself. Yet that young boy controlled his zipper. It was not about what he saw out. He controlled his zipper. Look at the men around you and tell them, control your zipper. You're afraid to tell them. Tell them. Abraham had enough reasons not to serve God. He had enough reasons. God appeared to him and gave him a prophetic word. You'll be the father of many nations. You'll have a child. For 25 miserable years, never had a child. 25 years is not a joke. Oh. Some of these people you see singing in the choir, they're not even 25. From the time they were born up until now, they're not yet 25. He had every reason not to serve God. He had every reason to backslide. But when the seed of a champion in you, when the resolution of a champion is in your heart, you will press on despite the difficulties of life. Champions are matured. Not always giving excuses. I cannot do this. Hey, this cannot be done. Hey, I cannot go to church. Hey, I cannot be a worker. Hey, I cannot. No. Look at somebody and say, grow up, grow up, grow up. Number three, champions walk alone. Say that with me. Joshua chapter 14, verse 8. The Bible says, Caleb said that I, nevertheless, my brethren who went up with me, made the heart of the people toward to melt. They made the heart of the people to melt. He said, but I brought back word as it was in my heart. Can you imagine? 2 out of 12. What percentage is that? Less than 10%. Less than 10%. So when you say, oh, the majority is right, the majority is not always right. When you say, well, that's what everybody is doing, everybody is not doing it. When you say, well, you have to do it the way we expect you to do. No. Who is it that you must obey? Peter walked out of the council with the Sanhedrin, and he asked them, he said, should we rather obey men than obey God? Caleb had a different testimony, because between where they went to spy the land until they got back to Moses, they must have had that conversation over and over and over and over, and some of them had decided what they were going to do. I'm sure just like a jury, some of them would have voted on what the outcome of the judgment would be even before the trial ended. They had had that conversation. But Caleb made up his mind and said, I am not going to go with these people. In Galatians chapter 1, verse 10, Paul said that, do I now persuade men or persuade God? He said, if I yet please men, then I am not a servant of God. You walk alone. You walk with God. You listen to the sound of a distant drummer. You capture a vision of the invisible. The Bible says of Moses, it said Moses endured as a man who saw the invisible. I want to ask you this morning, are you so influenced by your friends that you cannot stand alone? In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 8, chapter 2, verse 4, Paul said that as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, even so we speak not as pleasing man, but pleasing God. One translation says that our purpose has now become to please God, to make God our chiefest ambition. It's like that song. What is that song? One of these songs that I love so much. I've forgotten this song now. Not I Stand Amazed. Awesome God or something. You long to please God. You want to please God. One of the comments I've heard that have been made around and thrown around is that there's so much noise in church. Some people who sit at the back don't listen to the message. All they do is they're distracted. Some of them are watching sports channels when the message is going on. Some of them are texting and tweeting when the message is going on. You're not walking alone. There's too much noise around you. Too much noise. Too much distraction. Too much distraction. Too much noise. Some people say, Pastor, I want to come to church, but I find it difficult to come to church because there's so much noise, so much distraction. People are talking real and unreal things. So much noise. Walk alone. Walk. You see, that's why the Bible says in comparing the champion, in comparing the believer, he said that they that wait upon the Lord, they shall do what? They shall mount up on wings as eagles. You never see a flock of eagles. You never see eagles flocking together. No. Eagles walk alone. You wait upon the Lord. How? Alone. You spend time in private with God. How? Alone. You are intentional about your spiritual development. The Bible says, it said, let him that thinks take heed, lest he does what? He falls. The other day, I think my wife and I were having a conversation. And we were reviewing, or she was reviewing, some of the people who have compromised their marriages, who have violated their marriage vows. And I told her, I said, one reason why I have made up my mind not to violate my marriage vows is because I do not want to become part of the statistics. So that when they are saying that, oh, that one fell, oh, Jotakon also fell. I will not. May God deliver you from such statistical reference in Jesus' name. Be alone. Stand alone. If you go out for a conference with your friends and all of them are going around with naked girls, lock yourself up in the room and read the book of Proverbs. God will give you wisdom. Be alone. Be an eagle. Be different. The three Hebrew children, they made up their mind that they will be different. Don't say they were not tempted. Because temptation comes to everybody. By the way, do you know Jesus Christ faced every single temptation in the world? I tell people, I say, when Mary Magdalene came with seven demons, you think she came to get saved? Seven demons. You think she didn't come to get saved? The Bible said that he was tempted in every manner. Every manner. Yet he endured. Some of you are social drinkers. Not because you want to drink, But because you want to brag with your friends that what you can do, I can do too. You are social smokers. Not because you are a smoker, but simply because you want to belong. You want to belong on your way to hell. The Bible says every man shall give an account. What? Of his life. Your life. One sister told me, she said, yes, I'm married and I have children. But I tell my husband and my children, I say, listen, no, at the end of the day, it's everybody for himself. Look at somebody and say, you're alone, no? You didn't know that. Tell them. Uncle, tell your wife. Tell your wife. You're alone. You didn't know that. You're alone. You didn't know. They are loners. Not because they are antisocial, not because they are hostile to others, but because God is their heartthrob. Anything that will not connect them to God, they're willing to let it go. That business relationship, if it will take me away from God, they're willing to let it go. A young girl told her boyfriend, she says, since you have decided not to follow me to heaven, I have no plans to follow you to hell. Brethren, heaven is real. Caleb made up his mind. And no wonder he became such a champion. Number four, champions do exploits. Can you say that with me? Do exploits. In verse 12, look at verse 12. Joshua 14, 12. Are you being blessed this morning? Oh, come on, speak to me, somebody. Do I have a witness here today? Even if you are not, just say yes. And it will happen to you according to your words. They do exploits. In verse 12, the man was 85 years old. 85 years old. He said, give me this mountain. Give me this mountain. The Anakims are there. The giants are there. He said, it may be that the Lord will be with me and I will drive them out. They do exploits. Somebody may be sitting on your promotion right now. Somebody may be sitting on that girl you are supposed to marry right now. Drive them out. Drive. Come on, somebody. Drive them out. Somebody may be sitting on that man you are supposed to marry. Drive him out in the name of Jesus Christ. Somebody may be sitting on your husband. A man told me, he said he has a, some of you don't know this story, this mami water. You know about mami water? Whatever name you call it, mermaid or something, a mermaid. Not the one you see in Disney, real one, the demonic one. He said he had a mermaid wife. He told me he had a mermaid wife. He said wherever he is, that he may leave his house and go somewhere, that the moment that woman passes, and the woman is going to his house, he will leave whatever he's doing and go home. That when he's on the bed with his wife, when that woman shows up, the wife either has to leave the bed or he will leave the bed. Check out what's been happening to that guy. Every time he's running away from the house, follow him whether he's going to meet. So the man... Somebody may be sitting on your spouse. You've got to drive them away. Caleb said, I will do exploits. I am going to take what is my inheritance. In Mount Zion, there shall be deliverance. And the house of Jacob shall possess their possessions. May you possess your possessions in the name of Jesus. It will possess them. They will possess them. What is yours? It's yours. But you will not get, I'll talk about that shortly. But you've got to fight for it. Caleb said, I'm going to do exploits. Turn to Daniel chapter 11, verse 32. Daniel 11, 32. You know, I want you, listen to me, my brothers and my sisters. I do not want you to just live and die. Methuselah lived 969 years. And all that was said about him was that he lived and he died. Enoch walked with God. Noah found favor with God. He built an ark. The Anna, the widow, she was a widow. She made an impact. She was a widow. Socially ostracized. See, listen to me, my brothers and my sisters. Every human being has one limitations or the other. Forget all this Superman image you see on TV. Or you see the gloss and the glamour of the oil of anointing flowing when I'm talking. Every man has a limitation. And from my experience and my studies, I have discovered that people who have these limitations, they carry their limitations on their backs and they forge on in life and accomplish their goals. So, Anna was a widow. She spent time in the tabernacle fasting and praying for the arrival of the Messiah. That was her impact. I believe with all of my heart, as I read the Bible, that it must have been the intercession of Anna that kept Mary alive. Because don't forget, Mary was a young woman who had a pregnancy out of wedlock. Based on scriptures, she would have been stoned to death. Joseph would have been ostracized. There's no way Joseph could have kept her. But Anna must have been praying and praying and praying. And because Isaiah said it was a virgin that shall put to bed. It sounded incomprehensible, illogical, unscientific. But Anna must have said, God, if you said that, you must. That was why when Jesus was born, Anna was the woman who saw him when he came for christening. So don't tell me, I'm alone, nobody loves me. Nobody loves you, God loves you. And for crying out loud, please love yourself. Tell somebody, love yourself, love yourself. If nobody loves you, love yourself. Before your next birthday, go to Amazon. Buy a gift. Wrap it. Mail it to yourself. Go and buy some cards that are beautiful. Change your handwriting. Use your left hand to write it. Put your name on it. Mail it to yourself. On your birthday, the cards are coming. If I send flowers to yourself, when they come, you say, oh, God will bless that man who sent it. You are praying for yourself. Would God not bless you? Love yourself. Nobody knows the struggles. Get out of here. The God you serve is a wonderful God. The God you serve is an awesome God. When my father and my mother forsake me, the Lord will pick me up. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not. Oh, come on, do I have a witness here this morning? Two exploits for God. Rahab was a prostitute. When she encountered God, when she encountered the man of God, the Bible says she received them with peace. She decided, I will make an impact. I will see my brother make an impact. Can you hear me? My sister, don't see, history is an open, empty book. What you write on it will determine the outcome of your life. And it's not about being in a position of high visibility. In private, you are making an impact. You are transforming lives. You are touching individuals. You are blessing people. That is a champion. That's a champion. I'm trying. My sister, I'm trying. Just keep praying for me. I'm trying. For God, the people that know their God, let's have it, shall be what? Shall be strong. And they will do exploits. They will be strong. They will be strong. They will be strong. They will do exploits. Caleb conquered the land. He established peace. He conquered the land. The people that know their gods will not be gossips and petty-minded. All you are doing is choo 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 choo. You know everybody who comes to church with a new dress. How come? What were you looking at? I don't even remember the one I wore last week. You know the ones 12 other people wore. The people that know their God, they will do exploits. They will look for opportunities to serve. They will look for opportunities to be relevant. When you come to this place, you want to be relevant. When you get to church early, you look at the way the chairs are arranged. If they are not arranged well, you have to arrange them well before you sit down. You come to church early, 1 hour before church starts, to come and pray for church. You think God will not see you? You make a difference. You're a teacher in school. You teach the students in a way that you make an impact. I taught for 6 months. 6 months. If I went to university. And when I'm grading those students, I saw the students who, you know how teachers used to write that your case is hopeless. You know, I don't know, some of you went to those schools where the teachers would write the report at the end of the year. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Those of you who went to schools when schools were schools. You know, the teacher would write the report at the end of the year. One of our classmates. The previous year, I think the teacher wrote something funny. But the third term, that guy used to read like crazy. The third term, the teacher wrote, "So your case is hopeless." So we're calling him all kinds of names in school. I was tempted as a teacher, as I'm grading those students, I look at some cases, I want to say your case is hopeless. No, I won't write your case is hopeless, because words are powerful. I wrote something that will give them an opportunity for life. You know, the Bible tells a story of a woman, the woman of Nain, the widow of Nain, whose son died. His son died, and they put him in the coffin, and they were going to bury him. The Bible says that when Jesus showed up, it says the coffin was still open. The child had died, but the coffin was open. Because even in the deadness of your life, of your circumstances, there may still be a glimmer of hope. If the miracle worker shows up, he will do something new. So you have to give him an opportunity. It is dead, but it's not over until God says it's over. It is dead, but it's not completely dead. Leave the coffin open. Leave the casket open. Because as long as there is prayer, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man in avails. Can somebody help me preach this message this morning? Give God an opportunity to perform a miracle. The woman left the coffin open. If that woman had shut that casket, or like somebody said, if that woman was a Yoruba woman who says you will not see the corpse of your child, and she did not follow that casket to the grave, you think Jesus would have had compassion on a motherless casket that is going on his own? Jesus would have walked past by. Follow your miracle to his destination. Oh, can I preach this morning? Follow your miracle. Don't listen to what people say. What is yours. I declare it over your life today. You will get your inheritance in the name of Jesus. Yeah. Do exploits. I don't have time to preach this message. The Bible talks of three of David's warriors, three men. When the Bible talks about David's mighty men, it's like talking about the mighty men of City of David. You've been coming to this church, you have committed to be a worker, but you're not a mighty warrior. You are not a mighty worker. You are a lazy worker. You are a prayerless worker. You are a worker who gives me sleepless nights. You are a worker who makes me wonder what's happening to you when everything is going well with you. Because you are never at your post. The Bible talks about David's mighty warriors. It talks of three of them. He said one day, David just out of fantasy, he said, "Oh, I wish I could drink the waters of Jerusalem, of Bethlehem." These guys, they took their life in their hands. They broke through the camp of the Philistines. They went and fetched water, and they brought it to David. David looked at the water. He said, "Kai, this is blood water." He was afraid. He said, "No, I can't drink this water. I will sacrifice it to God." Those were men who have written their names on the pages of history. What is your own writing on the pages of history? Who could have thought that an endeavor like that? Because David was a type of Jesus. These were men who said, "We will do anything that God wants just to please the king." What is your own story? Tell me. "Oh, they said this about me. Hey, they said." You know, like I was talking with Brother Lekong. Lekong was talking to me, and we were talking, and he said, Pastor, now that we are going to build, we have to build. And I'm going to tell the church certain things. Because in this church, I have seen, he asked me a question. He said, Pastor, have you seen the cars that are parked outside? I said, yes, I know cars are parked outside. He said, people have been buying new cars. Oh. People have been buying new cars. He said, do you know that people have been moving into new houses? Even me, I've moved into a new house. And yet people are not giving for God's work. What is your own story? Listen. God has a sense of humor. If you do not do it, somebody will pick up somebody. God will pick up somebody who you did not think God will use and replace you. May you not be replaced. That's why I'm so confident. That's why I'm not afraid. The Bible says, let me add that one. Hebrews chapter 11. I will end on that note. It said, time will fail me. Hebrews 11, look at verse 32. Look at verse 32 and verse 34. It said, time will fail me. Time will fail me. What more shall we say of these things? Time will fail me to talk of great men in the city of David who have accomplished things for God. May your name be in that list. Next verse, verse 33. It says, through faith, they subdued kingdoms. They became champions. They worked righteousness. They obtained promises. Now, I was going to say something. You see, some of you, God has given you a promise. He gave you a promise. But that promise is in a shelf in the presence of God. In heaven, that promise, God gave you a promise. God wrote it down and he kept it in a shelf. It is your responsibility to go and obtain it. It's your responsibility. So time will fail me to tell of this man. They obtained promises. Go on to the next verse. They stopped the mouth of lions. The next verse, please. He said they quenched the violence of fire. They escaped the edge of the sword. Out of violence, out of weakness, were made strong. They became valiant in battle. They became strong in the process of the warfare. Some of you say, well, I cannot fast. How can you fast when you've not started fasting? How can you? My auntie is a witch. I will never visit her again. Of course, she's a witch because you have not gone there, fasted, loaded with anointing, and resisted the spirit in her. So that by the time you walk away, she knows that this one is different. I think I should stop this message. God wants you to live the life of a champion. Let's stand on our feet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just pray that God will make you strong in him. Father, make me strong. Go ahead and pray. Make me strong. Make me strong in you. Make me strong in you. Make me strong in you, oh God. Make me strong in you. Make me strong. Make me strong in you, oh God. Ah, shakate kebro sante. Membrande zikato lo seke de gevoshi kapa. Mande limbro sonto kaligi de gevoshi kaya. Ibro sante kalastaka. Joste kevo zombraya le ende genimozo sante. Ikabra sokoto. Jondaya le ende genimozo sante. Imbra sikato vege de gevoshi ke. Ikataya mambraya le endegenimozo zando. Ikidigi. Ikoto zombraye le endegenimozo zando. Jeke kaligi digi. Imbraye masonto. Vosante ke digi voshikaya. Father, make me strong. Make me strong to possess my inheritance. Make me strong to possess my possessions. Make me strong, O God, I ask you today. Father, I thank you this morning. I give you praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. You cannot be a champion if you are not born again. You cannot be a champion if you are backslidden. You're living in backsliding. Righteousness exalts. Sin is a reproach. You may think you're doing well. Wait, that thing has a way of affecting your grandchildren. It has a way. You may go, you may have it easy, go away. I can mention one or two wealthy people in Nigeria. Those of you from Nigeria, how many Nigerians are here? Raise up your hand, let me see. All you Nigerians, raise up your hand. Don't be ashamed of your country. Raise up your hand. Your naira is now, how many? 400 to $1. Raise up your hand, Nigerians. Tokumbo, suddenly you're not a Nigerian. Where are you from? Raise it up, both hands. That's where you're from. Deliverance will come to you people in Jesus. You know? I can name one or two people from Nigeria that you know. Wealthy, wealthy people. Today, you can't mention their children. Is that wealth? That's not wealth. Wealth that cannot be transgenerational. It's not wealth. Righteousness exalts a nation. Sin is a reproach to any people. If you are backslidden, if you are not born again, this is the moment for you to say, Lord, I come to you. Let's close our eyes. Put your hand on your chest and say, Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, have mercy on me. Lord, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me, O God. Have mercy on me. Let your blood avail for me. Let me live a godly life. Let me live a holy life. Restore me to yourself, O God. Have mercy on me. Father, we thank you today. We bless your holy name, O God. I break the power of the enemy over the lives of your people today. I command the hold of the devil to be broken in the name of Jesus Christ. Every work of the enemy, every work of sin and bad habits and demonic oppression, today I bring deliverance over the people of God in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Father, we thank you for your grace. Thank you for your healing. Thank you for your salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. And let the people of God say good. Amen.